Good evening and welcome again to Through the Lens here at the Belmont Media Center. We bring you the 92nd episode of Through the Lens where we talk about the movies.
Wait a minute. All right, we're done. Let's go.
All right,
cool. We're out of here.
The woefully underdressed Mike Higgins. And I'm also joined by...
I missed the memo. You said it was a 92nd episode, so how are we going to get through?
It was the 92nd episode.
Oh, episode 92, not a minute and a half episode.
No.
I would have got my wish.
Sorry. I hate to disappoint you like that.
Yeah, he didn't get the memo. Ties are now mandatory.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
I would have worn that tie, Bill.
And as you can tell,
the Red Sox sweatshirt over the Speed Racer tie.
As you can tell by the tie worn by my esteemed colleague.
I'm esteemed.
Esteemed colleague, fellow member of the Wrecking Crew. He will be reviewing Speed Racer, which came out in theaters last week.
It did?
And I believe it did. And Bill and I will be reviewing, not Bill and I, Mike and I rather will be reviewing.
On the other side there. There you go.
Yes.
Skippy.
Iron Man. And he's also seen something else as well, so we'll get to
that
in a little bit.
A very disturbing sight.
But we are going to kick things off this evening with the most recent of the movies to be reviewed, and that would be Speed Racer with Bill the Real McCoy.
Here comes Bill McCoy. He's a demon on wheels. Turn. He's a demon,
right.
And he's going to be chasing
Speed Racer, based on a 1960s Japanese anime. The Wachowski or Wachowski, however you pronounce it.
The idiots who did The Matrix.
The idiots who did The Matrix, brothers. It's a two-hour movie. A cartoon does not need to be made into a two-hour movie, especially when you have a no-talent like Matthew Fox as Racer X. The animated Racer X has more talent than Matthew Fox. Also, you have Emil Hirsch as Speed Racer, Christina Ricci as Trixie, Susan Sarandon and John Goodman as Speed's parents.
And wait, Susan Sarandon isn't that Drek?
Yeah, she's the mom. She's Mom Racer.
Nice.
You did not know that, obviously.
Nope.
Take the Oscar away now.
This is one of those movies. Yeah, there's a lot of action and corniness and stuff. But as someone who grew up watching that, running home from school to watch that cartoon, it's kind of like you're crushing my childhood memory. For that, I cannot forgive you. This movie, it could have made an hour and 20 minute movie, and I think it would have been better. You didn't need to drag it out for just over 2 hours. I don't think it was worth it. Now, some of the kids might enjoy it. In fact, some of the kids in the theater did like the movie, and others were like, had no clue what was going on at all, because there's some allusions to the old series and stuff, but really it wasn't a good movie. Yeah, there was some good special effects and everything, Matrix style special effects, but still, and I'm not a fan of the Matrix anyway. I thought the first one was fine,
overrated.
And after that, go away. It was a movie that, yeah, if you want to see it at the matinee where you don't have to pay as much, go for it. But as far as spending money at nighttime where you're paying an arm and a leg, it's really not worth it. Yeah, it has the usual demon or evil company that's trying to force Speed to do things. And of course, he's goody two-shoes. And says, no, I can't do that. I'm honorable and all that type of stuff. But, I mean, it was predictable. And me knowing the original series and everything, it was kind of like you were crushing my childhood memory, as I said before. And I just didn't think it was that good. And apparently now there's a new Speed Racer series starting up. I think it's this weekend.
Just stop them.
Just
stop them now.
In fact, there was one in the early 90s. I remember coming home one night. And I think it was on the Cartoon Network, and I'm like, Speed Racer's on. And I'm like, wait a minute, this isn't the Speed Racer I know. And unfortunately, the other thing is, yeah, it's set up, you could have a sequel to it, depending on how the box office does, and actually the box office is doing not quite as good as they want, so I really don't see them doing another Speed Racer movie. It's one of those, yeah, there's action and everything, and it might be entertaining for some people that don't know anything about the old series, but if you watch the old series, which I do have, then it's kind of like, why? No more. Don't do it again. It's not a movie I'd want to go see again.
Yeah, and I think it's going to get hurt quite a bit by some upcoming movies coming out, too, especially for kids like... You know,
Kung Fu Panda?
No, not Kung Fu Panda, but, you know, The Chronicles of Narnia, yeah. which yep. is actually opening today.
That's crushing it. Iron Man crushing it,
which we'll be getting to in a moment.
And then you got Indiana Jones coming out.
Next week, exactly. So I think their numbers are going to drop off quite dramatically.
Whoever thought of putting it on at this time to drop the ball because of all these other movies. And Speed Racer, yeah, it has a following with people my age maybe, but for other people it's like, no. Yeah, I think they're trying to hope
they're trying to pull in a new crowd.
The anime crowd.
Right.
But I don't really think it works.
Yeah.
And the popcorn was bad too.
Well, that's
worst
never
movie
a good
upset
ever.
Stomach.
Worst movie ever.
Worst movie ever?
Goodness.
I still got to go with my favorite Martian. The first one I reviewed was really bad.
I was going to say, that was some bad reviews from that one.
Even though I did make the comment in that one that Daryl Hannah should never act, but she actually did a good job in the Kill Bill movie. Yeah. But Matthew Fox, you
the
should
black hole of charisma?
Yeah, she remained lost.
Oh, wow. All right, well, moving on. You alluded to this before, but the next movie that we're going to take a look at is Iron Man.
I thought it was the guy Iron Man.
Okay. Oh, you need some help, professional and otherwise. But Iron Man, based on the Marvel comic of the same name, being, excuse me, starring... Robert Downey Jr. as Tony Stark, who is the chairman of a defense contractor who makes weapons for the military. His second in command, Jeff Bridges, and his assistant, Gwyneth Paltrow. And excuse me, he ends up being kidnapped at the beginning of the movie, which is not you see that at the beginning in the trailer, so I'm not giving anything away. But he is kidnapped in the Middle East and forced to try to make a weapon, some rockets for this band of terrorists who happen to be also purchasing his weapons, which he finds out as he's being held captive. So he creates this suit, this Iron Man suit, to help in his escape. And when he gets home, he has he's got a conscience now, so he's not going to be selling weapons anymore. He wants to design this suit, for military and so on and so forth, or whatever the case may be. So that's the bulk of the movie, is him trying to design this suit after he gets back from his captivity. He is trying to, design this suit as he is, being ridiculed and criticized by the entire, weapons community and his own, board of directors is trying to oust him so that they can, continue to sell things to nefarious people. Bill, I think Mike might have something to say.
I was communicating something with Bill, but I will add in there at this point, because not to give a summary, but I got to say the one thing I found about this movie was that it was very fun. I mean, there's a great sense of humor to this movie. It's a comic book movie,
mm-hmm.
So
yes.
it is in fact. Parts of it are completely ridiculous. I mean, the fact that he's got shrapnel in his chest and he has to invent an electromagnet hooked to a car battery at first to keep it away from his heart. Okay, you take the disbelief and you suspend it real big.
Oh, yeah.
But
there's no basis in reality whatsoever, which is okay for this because
it's a comic book.
Based on the comic book.
But it was very witty. Robert Downey Jr. is a lot of fun in this role. I mean, he's an actor who's had his troubles and been away for a while and done some very serious stuff. Chaplin being one that I always remember
Excellent
him
movie.
In. But he takes to this role very well. And the thing I liked about Iron Man, and I commented this to my wife as we left the theater, the one thing I found extremely unusual about Iron Man is that it's the first superhero where he's not a tortured soul. He's not like a Spider-Man is this tortured soul who was bitten. Batman has that dark side where he's this, He embraces it. Tony Stark embraces being Iron Man and loves it and looks at it as an opportunity and basically acknowledges it and is having fun with it. And that carries on through the entire movie. I mean, the special effects are great, but the acting is good. Even Gwyneth Paltrow as the unfortunately named Pepper Potts.
Right.
Could you get more 1940 screwball comedy name? does well in the role. It's a small role, but it is what it is. It's a big, loud action movie that moves very quickly. Mm-hmm. You know, the plot is fairly easy to follow, whether it strains credulity or not, it's one thing. But it's fun, and that's what you want when you go to a movie like that, when you go see Iron Man, is it's fun. I mean,
absolutely.
And that's the main thing I can say is that, you know, Batman I'm looking forward to, but that's going to be dark. I mean,
yes.
It's still going to be good. This was just fun, like the first Spider-Man, where you just had the joy in going to a movie, and it was nice to see that.
Yeah, and you know how big I am about, you know, whether or not a movie is entertaining. Is this going to win any Oscars? Is it going to get any critical acclaim? No, probably not.
May win special effects Oscars.
Perhaps special effects, but we'll have to wait and see after, you know, the big summer blockbusters come out that are going to be heavy in the special effects. But it is wildly entertaining, and I thoroughly enjoyed myself. And not being a comic book fan myself, I did not know a great deal of the story going in.
And you don't need to.
You don't need to in the movie. You're able to follow it very nicely. And again, there is no basis in reality whatsoever, but in this particular case, it works fine simply because, you know, you're working in a, you know, a genre that really is not reality in any way, shape, or form anyway. So it works out fine. And I would highly recommend it. Again, a very entertaining evening.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. And, you know, I'm not, and whoa, we just had a small earthquake. We're okay right here now, but a 3.2, you know, if the earthquake could jiggle the camera over just a little bit more to that way, because we're off center there. It's amazing how you can control the tremors like that. I know very little about the comics, but I knew that there are a couple of very casual references here and there, and there is a scene after the credits that has absolutely nothing to do with the movie. And if you don't know the comics like I did, you go, yeah, so. But it does set up a future plans for other superhero movies where they're going to do crossovers. And if you go see The Hulk, which is coming out this summer, is not the Ang Lee disaster. It actually looks good.
With Edward Norton.
Tony Stark, which is another Marvel thing, Tony Stark, Robert Downey Jr.'s Tony Stark, is going to show up in The Hulk. I don't know if he's going to be in the Iron Man suit, but he has a cameo role or something in that where they're going to cross over and they're eventually going to unite all these Marvel superheroes down the road. So I think it's actually an interesting concept, but it's a good movie.
Well, we'll have to wait and see.
Yep.
We'll have to wait and see. I don't know. I don't know what kind of a timeline they have working for that.
I think it's 2011 or 12 when they're going to do that. I mean,
You have some time to get all the other, you know, movies out of the way first and set up the story for the big conglomerate. All right. Well, moving on. We have one more movie to review, and then I think we're going to discuss a bit later on. But he's got a Speed Racer t-shirt on, too.
Yeah, and he's changed.
Real Speed Racer, not the movie version.
This is why I was so distracted doing my review. I got to look at Bill changing.
Well, all I did was take me out of shirt.
I mean, come on. Ebert never changed.
Oh, goodness.
He should have. He's had a lot of sweat on his
arm. Or Roper. Can't forget Roper.
Mr. Roper?
A Speed Racer t-shirt. The epitome of professionalism.
Look at him.
Yeah, this is true, too. Hey, what can I do?
Go, Speed Racer.
Anyway.
Mike
saw another movie that he wanted to talk about real quick.
It's,
and
it's
was,
actually playing at the Belmont Studio Cinema this week. So I like to bring you localize it because I work in a local business. Well, I work in Maine, but we localize everything. It's Forgetting Sarah Marshall. It's a new comedy from the Judd Apatow School of Comedy. 40-year-old virgin, super bad. This one stars Jason Segel, who's better known as Marshall. That's kind of a weird coincidence, on How I Met Your Mother, which is on TV right now, a show I've recently discovered. And Kristen Bell as the aforementioned Sarah Marshall, and Mila Kunis as this desk clerk in Hawaii figure who's the love interest. She played Jackie on The 70s Show. She's not nearly as obnoxious in this as she is in The 70s Show. This is a very funny movie. It is a very hard R, though. You do not want to take the kids to see it. And as a guy, the first 15 minutes is completely unnecessary as Sarah Marshall breaks up with her boyfriend and he's completely naked. And they show it all several times. So ladies, you may want to go check out Forgetting Sarah Marshall. She's a famous television star. He's a composer, does the music on the TV series. They break up at the beginning of the movie. He's devastated. She's got a new boyfriend. He goes to Hawaii to forget about her. She's staying at the same resort.
Nice.
You know, if you're into the 40-year-old version, it is kind of a raunchy comedy. Other than the nudity at the beginning, there isn't a lot of nudity. There are some sex scenes that are played very funny. including one where Sarah Marshall and her new boyfriend and, you know, her ex and his new girlfriend are in adjoining rooms, and they're trying to outshout each other, which is pretty hysterical, actually. It's been in theaters for a few weeks. It's definitely, you know, more of an adult comedy, but it's very well written. Jason Segel is pretty good in this. I mean, he doesn't play quite the same character as he does on How I Met Your Mother, but it was still kind of this big schlub who just wanted to get over this bad breakup, and you can identify with him. You know, we've all been there, and it was good. I'd recommend it. It was pretty funny. Few really good laugh out loud moments, none of which that I can say on the air. Except the end, which involves a musical with puppets, a Dracula musical with puppets, which is just strange.
Yeah, just the thought of it.
Yeah, it's strange, but it's enjoyable. There's a lot of little cameos. The guy that was in Superbad, I can't think of his name. Big heavy set guy with curly hair. He plays
maitre d' or something.
Yeah, he plays a maitre d' who's obsessed with this musician who's dating Sarah Marshall, and it gets weirder and weirder by the end. And so it was good. I would say definitely go see Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
Excellent. Yeah. Excellent. So we've got, two movies that
worth seeing,
and one not so much.
I could have told you Speed Racer wasn't worth seeing.
I knew Speed Racer was going to be tough even before I went into the theater. It was just, I grew up watching it. I had to see it, and
I grew up watching it, and I went to see Iron Man instead.
Yeah, okay, you got me. It was just awful.
Awful. One other thing about Iron Man that I just remembered, that was directed by Jon Favreau, which you've seen Swingers, and he was in Rudy, and it's just one of those things, another actor turned director, little tie-ins, but either way. Just, I forgot to mention it before, and I wanted to bring it up. It was in fact directed by Jon Favreau.
Well, this is now kind of the beginning of the summer season. There's going to be a lot of things coming up.
Well, I think Iron Man and Speed Racer are definitely the initial thing. And summer is getting earlier and earlier every, you know, movie-wise.
Yeah, but I still think they're trying. Well, I mean, it's traditionally Memorial Day weekend has always been the unofficial start to summer and movie season anyway, but they did release these a couple of weeks early. Well, they've been doing that, you know, every year, getting about a week or so earlier.
Well, they were also getting out of the way of the room.
Exactly.
The one that's taking over Memorial Day weekend, and it doesn't make sense because that's probably one of the most anticipated movies in the last 10 years.
Oh, yeah.
And will probably end up, you know, being very high up in the box office tallies probably until Batman is released later in July.
Yeah.
Oh, those, I would gather. But
I'd say those would probably be the two big ones. This summer.
You think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We are, of course, talking about Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull.
Absolutely.
Just the trailer. They do it right because you hear that dun da 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 da, and the guy in the shadow of the hat. You're hooked. Forget about it. You're going to go see the movie. Anyone over the age of 18 is going to go see the movie automatically.
Absolutely. And the makers of National Treasure right now is thinking, God, Oz was a piece of junk compared to this.
But I like the two National Treasure movies.
Yeah, but they're different. Movies. They're a little. They're just.
How about the producer of the first Mummy, which could have been easily an Indiana Jones movie? And there's a third Mummy movie coming out this summer.
There is?
Really?
Set in China. We'll talk about that later.
Not the same cast, is it?
Yeah, everyone but the woman who won an Oscar and now decides she's. Oh, and the original Mummy. Now it's Jet Li because it's in China. But Brendan Fraser is back. And his son, who was 10 in the last movie, is now 23. So.
Wow.
It's kind of like the Barry Bonzo from Family Ties aging. He's a baby one summer, then he's 8 the next fall. So yeah. But I digress. I did that well.
We always digress.
We do. But getting back to the summer blockbusters coming out again, we mentioned the big one.
I mean, this is a sequel to
the
first
one.
There is one I do want to see. 1981.
1981 was the first one. The last one.
1989.
Right, 1989. The Last Crusade. And, I mean, it's almost 20 years since, 20 year gap in there. And you don't see that, you see that in, remakes of original movies and things like that.
But this has the same writer, same
which is very unusual.
Producers,
yeah.
The whole nine yards.
We were talking about that earlier, and really the only other one we could really come up with definitely was Godfather 3.
We had the Rocky and the Rambo sequels, but that had a lot of different elements to it. The one thing I will say about this that I've heard is, thank God for Steven Spielberg, because if George Lucas was solely involved in it, this would have been Drac. He wanted, Lucas evidently wanted Spielberg to shoot this digitally, like he shot the Star Wars one, and Spielberg said no. And he shot it originally on film, so it's going to have the look of the original ones, other than the Star Wars prequels that George Lucas evidently should never direct or never write a movie. Just come up with a concept and walk away.
And let other people
handle it. So, you know, he's producing it, but he's producing it, but it's in the hands of someone who's not a moron in directing movies.
Good point.
Well, yeah, and I mean, either way, you can't, hardly ever can you go wrong with Spielberg, you know, at the helm.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, he has
1941.
Done some, yeah, I was just going to say.
All right, whatever.
Oh, but snap!
Either way, AI wasn't my favorite either. That was more Kubrick than Spielberg. But either way. You know, and then later on, we have Batman coming out, which
will be the greatest movie ever released.
Well, I don't know about that, but
it's going to definitely get a big pop. Those probably be the two that are going to make the most money.
Oh, I would.
Harry Potter will do good.
That's in November.
But I think that will really be. I don't think that's going to come close to these.
No, because that's the sixth. What people will pop for is in a couple of years when the seventh one comes out, and you'll have all the big scenes in the Harry Potter.
Right.
You know, Harry battling Dumbledore, Snape being killed. It's the big event movie of the series.
There is one I want to see. I mean, I don't think it'll do good depending on the date it comes out, is Get Smart.
Yeah, that looks like it's going to be extremely funny. That looks like, that's another case where you've remade a show like Speed Racer. You've remade a show where half the audience isn't going to realize that there was a TV show, Get Smart, or have any knowledge of Don Adams' work in that. But I think it'll work. I mean, Steve Carell is now, he's gone from this dweeb on The Daily Show to a major movie and TV star.
Oh, he's huge now, yeah.
And the one that's scary who's in that movie?
Dwayne Johnson.
Dwayne Johnson, who's no longer known as The Rock. How do you go from the wrestling ring to
Get Smart?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. And he's a good actor. That's
he's actually he done is. A lot. He is not, he's got he the is right personality for it. And right now, he's kind of considered Disney safe.
Yeah, well.
Yeah. Yeah,
maybe
so
Disney should go back and watch some of his stuff. Well, after what happened with Miley Cyrus, maybe they'll like The Rock anyways.
Yeah.
That could be, he'll become Disney's new golden child. But
Hannah Montana with The Rock.
Either way. So really looking forward to Batman coming out in, it's July, right?
July, it comes out like July 21st. I know it's going to be on IMAX too.
Is there anything coming out for July 4th weekend?
Yes, Hancock with Will Smith, where he plays a down-and-out superhero that actually causes more harm than good. And the people in Los Angeles kind of hate him because he's pretty much like a drunk and destroys everything when he tries to save people. Promise. Could be bad, but has promise.
Has promise. Mm-hmm. And there's no Will Smith movies opening up this 4th of July weekend. Which
Matt, Hancock.
Hancock,
opening 4th of July with Will Smith.
Oh, was Will Smith in it? Wow, see?
Those two things on the side of your head.
Obviously, he wasn't
paying
attention.
You used on the lesson there, Slappy.
I heard, no, you said Will Smith.
Never mind.
I thought he said Will Smith.
There's no Will Smith movies coming out at all, and I don't know why on the 4th of July. Just that one, Hancock with Will Smith. I don't know. Oh, God.
I heard Will Ferrell. My apologies. Either way.
Ferrell Smith. Yeah, it sounds like.
Yeah, it does. It's been one of those days. Now, what else is coming up?
Mamma Mia with
Meryl
Streep.
We need to have that one.
You know, it's like Hairspray. Hairspray.
Well,
hit.
I know it's like
the producers hit. They're going to make a Broadway. They're going to make a movie out of every Broadway show.
Well, it's because they ran out of TV shows to use.
Yeah.
You know, except for Speed Racer.
I'm sure they can come up with more TV shows.
Well, I'm sure they will. Just give it a couple more years, and you're going to end up seeing Friends movies and.
Oh, please.
You know.
Sex
well,
in the City.
That's
a good example of another
there
thing.
There you go.
It's dead. Let it die. I don't need to see Cynthia Nixon, Kim Cattrall, and Sarah Jessica Parker.
And whoever the other one is.
You know, Sarah, how many movies have you done? The ugliest woman in America, Sarah Jessica Parker.
One of.
I wouldn't say the ugliest, but she's definitely.
She's a horse face.
She's definitely overrated as anybody that says she's glamorous and attractive. No, she's not.
I mean, Matthew Broderick probably looks and goes, Bueller,
Bueller,
Bueller, class, anyone, why did I marry her, class, anyone, class. So, I mean, you know, there are good movies coming out this summer, but then you see Drac like Speed Racer out there, and you just wonder, the sad thing is people spend millions of dollars to make this stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and more people go to the movies.
And they will continue to do TV shows into movies. I mean, Johnny Depp's doing Dark Shadows. You know, I think that could be good.
Yeah, again, it comes down, you know, to, we've mentioned this, you know, numerous times over the past almost 10 years now, is just a lack of original thoughts coming out of the Hollywood studios. If you want, you know, good original material, you got to go, you know, watch some indie films.
Which we haven't really done a lot of.
No, we don't get a whole lot of that. I mean, in my area, there's not a whole lot of, you know, theaters that are running the indie films, too. So, no. It's tough for me to get out. I mean, it's tough for me to get out at L to see a movie anyway.
If you'd like us to do more indie films, you could send us money and we'll pay, which will pay for us to go see more indie films.
You could certainly do that as well, but either way. But come back to the, you know, TV shows and, you know.
But when they're done right, they're good.
They certainly can.
Adam's Family was good. The Brady Bunch was good.
Good, okay.
The Fugitive was good.
Yeah, the second one was like, okay, you don't need to make that one.
But when they're done wrong, a.k.a.
Starsky and Hutch.
Racer, even Starsky and Hutch.
My Favorite Martian.
My Favorite
Dukes of Hazzard.
Yeah, I mean, crap like that.
Dukes of Hazzard, you knew it was going to be a dumb movie from the get-go, though.
How much money we could make on studios, surely out of saving money, if they hired us just to sit around a room all day and have people come in and pitch their movies just before they're about to make them, and we'll look at them and go, no.
No.
No, crap.
No.
Move on.
Next.
It would save so much. The Olsen twins would be working at Starbucks if I was in Hollywood. They would never do anything again. Lindsay Lohan, gone.
Yeah.
Paris Hilton, gone. I mean, you know, just stop these people from making movies.
Yeah.
Make good movies.
Yeah. Unless they're, you know, making this direct just for, like, tax.
But even the best actors and actresses make bad movies. Look at Al Pacino's latest, 88 Minutes.
What are they thinking when they make this stuff? It's just, it's...
Well, what can you do?
It's
maybe that's why we're not, you know, Hollywood agents to the stars.
Yes, because we would be honest and look at them and go... Crap! Seriously? You want to do Speed Racer as a live-action anime with colors that'll induce seizures? Crap! Just give me the money.
Mm. There you go.
Make a movie of three of us sitting around for 2 hours talking about that.
That's right. That would work.
That'll work.
That would absolutely work.
David Kelly, you live in Belmont. You have family in Belmont. I love Boston Legal. Send us money. We'll make a show for you.
Hey, I like that. A movie within a movie of us reviewing bad movies.
Yes.
There you go. And, you know, there's some movies filming in Boston coming up pretty soon, too. One with Leonardo DiCaprio?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And I know Bruce Willis is actually going to be filming.
He is right now.
Right around the corner from where I work in Worcester. He's going to be there later on, in a couple of weeks anyway.
In Worcester, yes.
I forget the name of the movie. But anyway, you have any thoughts, comments, questions? By all means, send us an email. The email is throughthelenstv@aol.com.
David, that's how you can reach us for our show idea. We love you, baby. Denny Crane.
And I can personally guarantee you that all emails will be answered. So please, by all means, go ahead.
Lengthy personal response.
And next week, absolutely. Next time, we'll review Frasier, the movie.
Goodness gracious.
60 Minutes, the movie.
Well, next time I gather, we're going to be heavy on the Indiana Jones and,
Bill, you know, Bill's coming with a whip and a hat.
Bill's going to be wearing a whip.
That'll work.
Wow. All right.
We're out of here.
Email through the lens at AOL TV, throughthelenstv@aol.com. Thanks.
Bye.
Have a good night.
Bye.
Night.